You're next in line for the official Holiday World Podcast.
Welcome to Holiday World and Splash and Safari.
Dropping in from Santa Claus, Indiana.
Riders will experience swift acceleration, high-speed turns, and sudden stops.
With park president and CEO, Matt Eckert.
Speak loudly so us old people can hear you.
Vice president and COO, Matt Bloomhart.
I love it.
Media relations manager, Sabrina Jones.
Here I am on vacation doing touristy things.
Director of entertainment and events and fourth-generation owner, Lauren Crosby.
Can I sing a Taylor Swift song now?
And director of communications and fourth-generation owner, Leah Cook.
That's why emojis exist.
Now stow your loose articles, buckle up,
and please keep your hands and legs inside the car at all times.
And we're back. Welcome back to season four of the official Holiday World podcast. This is season four, episode one. It's officially been retitled, the one where what's going on?
today is named.
Friday, January 14th for us, but we expect to release this episode. Honestly, we're not even sure yet, guys.
You'll get it when you get it.
Yeah, you'll get it when you get it.
We're just being very fluid today.
Yep. So welcome to the podcast table. We've got Josh, who normally sits in the sound booth, but...
Thanks for having me on this side.
Thanks for joining.
We needed you.
Thanks.
We had to force him over, but you know, we appreciate you coming. We've got Sabrina, as always.
Good morning.
Welcome back, our media relations manager. And of course, we have president and CEO, Matt Eckert.
Happy New Year.
And bringer of donuts this
and
morning.
Bringer of donuts. That's a better title, actually.
Right?
I mean, Matt brought donuts.
You make more friends that way.
And of course, Lauren and Matt can't join for the donuts.
Right.
So
Sorry.
Lauren's got a sick kid today, and Matt and I have battled a cold. Well, I battled the cold longer and more valiantly, I would argue. And he's not here to defend himself, so that's the record.
That's what we're going to say.
But he still has a cough when he laughs. So we're down a couple people here, and you know, we're going to wait and kind of answer the full volume of questions once we have a full table of people. Hopefully we can do that one day again. I tell you what, guys.
It'll happen.
This is a crazy time of year.
It is.
I hope everyone's staying safe. Working from home when we can. This is a rare exception day where we're all still obviously socially distanced, but you know, here at the table.
We're here.
Yeah. So anything going on with you guys before we jump into questions? Anything exciting happening in our world? I feel like we have some like things that we can't talk about yet just in case they don't happen. So there's that.
Right.
Hyena Falls is coming down.
Hyena Falls is coming down.
And that should be like the London Bridge.
Yes.
It's almost public domain, right?
I think it is now.
Steven, check that. Like the... That's one of those things, like, we knew it was coming down or we found out. And I don't know if I just started pretending like it wasn't there in my mind, but man, it makes a difference when you look at the hill. Like, you just see Thunderbird now, and it's such a nice, clear shot of Thunderbird. Mm-hmm. So I appreciate that and all the work they're doing.
We did it for you, Sabrina. Yeah.
I appreciate it.
As Matt B puts it, now you can really see the $22 million coaster we put up
there.
Because
right.
Right. You couldn't see it before,
right.
Matt.
Right.
But
it makes him feel better, though, so let him say that.
But for those of you who are heartbroken, I just want to say we're sorry. It just kind of was the one ride that was easy to cut out. It was even on our busiest days, just the location didn't really work out very well. I know there are some questions here in the deck that I've prepared for this about whether we would repurpose those slides. And the answer is, we would essentially need to purchase all new fiberglass and build a whole new ride.
Right.
So if we're going to do that, we'll probably consider something a little different or a little more, you know, unique, something else. So that's not a hint for what's coming. I feel like I always have to add
that. Don't overanalyze.
Yes. Let's remember 2020 was not our best year by a long shot. And 2021 has been a great year, but we're still in recovery mode.
Mm-hmm.
All righty. So, well, while we're... figuring out what we're doing right now with our small team of people and being down some people. Let's jump into some of the most frequently asked questions from our list. We'll get to more of these questions in another episode. There are just certain ones that I know that, you know, I'd like to have Lauren here and I'd like to have at least read in front of Matt B because I think there will be some good reactions on those. There are also plenty of holidays that I picked, assuming that Matt B would be here as per the last one. So I'm like, darn it. I know how to like predict reactions out of other people, like him more than other people. Mm-hmm. And so I'm like,
you know what button to push.
Yes. Exactly. I know which things will get rants started out of Matt, and there's nothing funnier
hard.
Than a Matt B. Yeah. rant.
That's not hard.
No, it is not. But they're also hilarious. Like, even when he is at his most angry about a certain issue or topic, I'm still just like, he gets so worked up over
passion.
It. That's like, and he's never like fully angry. It's passionate, right. But it's funny. But he gets just as passionate about really ridiculous and silly things too. So I'm going to kick things off with the number one question. Is anything new for 2022? The answer is possibly. The answer is we don't know yet, but we don't have a new ride coming. I'll tell you that right mm-hmm. now. We have some great work going on at the Legend that hopefully we're going to be able to update you in the next episode or two about. I think ACE members have gotten a special preview of what's going mm-hmm. on this past weekend, or you can hit the blog where there's a post that kind of explains what we're doing. Anything else coming new in 2022? I'm trying to think of,
you know, I think 2022, we're still focusing on, staying true to who we are and staying true to who we have been and just maintaining the quality of the park so that when you, walk through the gates, it's going to feel like the park you've always came to and even better.
Mm-hmm. And that takes a lot of work.
It does.
It just doesn't sit and not age and not change in the winter.
I say all the time, we're a small, large park. Mm-hmm. I mean, where we once used to be considered one of the small parks, we're really not a small park anymore.
Yeah, right.
So it does take a lot of year-round work from, we have almost 100 employees. We have over 100 full-time mm-hmm. employees, and it takes mm-hmm. everyone to do a little bit of everything to keep us in the shape that we're in, and we're in pretty darn good shape.
Mm-hmm. That's a good point. So I was just thinking about this the other day that we were so excited to talk about it going into 2020, and then we never really got a chance to. But even little things like, the old Rough Riders queue was about take me minus 2 inches wide.
It was sideways shimmy big.
Yeah, I had to walk sideways up that thing. Stephen's raising his hand back there too. we redid that and going into 2020. And that's the thing that we didn't really get to talk about. But, there are a lot of attractions like that, that when they've been around for that long, there's a lot of queues that we would never build that way now. Mm-hmm. But, things were different then. And so it's been nice to go through and, we just mm-hmm. changed the way that the queue started and magically had all the space we needed to make that a more adult, human-friendly queue. People must have been way smaller when they built that.
Right, surely. I think too, we try to do a lot of things to improve the aesthetics of the park. So like last year, we resealed our pathways. Mm-hmm. That sounds like a minor thing. It made a huge mm-hmm. difference in just the
now.
Way the park yeah. looked and felt as you were walking through it. And so those little things add up. Those little things truly do make a lot of difference. So I think, that's kind of the focus for 2022 is we're focusing a lot on the little things this mm-hmm. year that are going to make a big impact.
Well, this past year, too, we started repainting the Pepsi Oases kind of mm-hmm. slowly over time. But, those red Pepsi Oasis stations in 4th of July are awesome.
They were on it, too, man. Like,
so
it was
good.
Like the next day we were closed. They're like already like out there and mm-hmm. had things down. And, even in the middle of the season, you'll find in the early mornings, was it Wildebeestro they painted? Holy mm-hmm. moly. It looked like, as I'm out getting my park snacks, I was like,
what you have to do.
That you do. And I frequently find myself in that corner getting those little mini corn dogs. Like, wow, that makes a big impact. Like, and they were just freshening up the colors that were already there. So mm-hmm. lots of paint.
And speaking of freshening up too, of course, 3 more carousel horses are in the works right now. I think every year we take at least 1 mm-hmm. row down. This year, I believe it's a 1-row year, but our paint shop team, we have 2 different types of paint shop. We mm-hmm. have the official big paint shop that paints buildings and lots of, big exterior things and walls and things like that. And then we have our more, our sign shop that does mm-hmm. murals and things like that as well. And so the horses go back and forth between the shops. So they start up at the paint shop where they... Sabrina can probably talk better. They blast it, right?
Yeah, they basically
take all the paint off. Yeah,
they take all the paint, all the jewels. Like, there's like a lot of details that go mm-hmm. on. So they like strip it down, basically prep it, prime it, and get it ready. And then it goes off to the print shop where it gets all of its detail work done, and it's unreal all the research they do to, you know, pick it, mm-hmm. because, you know, again, we're transforming it from a, I think it was an Arizona before, Arizona themed carousel to an Indiana carousel. So mm-hmm. that, you know, adding some corn and some cabins and some Lincoln touches and stuff like that. All the glorious Indiana, not to sound yes. like Parks and Rec or there's no shame
the
in
Parks
that.
Parks and Rec horse, Loki.
Yes, yes, yes. So maybe we should get Leslie Knope on one. Like, can we do that?
Oh my gosh. I would.
With a hatchet.
I would die.
Like, can we do that?
That would be amazing.
But yeah, so like they pass it on, and then at the print shop is where it gets all the details. And then like he like painstakingly picks out I feel like rhinestone's the wrong word, but it's like
gem.
Yeah, they're like gems. I mean, they're like gems.
Yeah.
And he talked about how like sourcing them is really hard because of the limited number of these things and to get them to fit. And yeah. So
I'm sure there's like a costume jewelry supply place that he has to go through for those, but it's incredible work, and he goes through, and I mean, those horses look just as good, if not better, than mm-hmm. they did to start with. So, well, they look better anyway because they've been repainted, right. but they have the detail that they do. But then they have to, after that, go back up to the paint shop yes. for a gloss coat finish.
It's like glittery and shiny.
It's yeah. a process.
Mm-hmm. It is a process, but yeah, there's plenty of things that go on in the off season that
we got. Bakuli's getting some love this year.
Oh yeah!
Like if you're anywhere on the back half of the water park, my eyes always end up in that direction. So it's always nice to see them cleaned in the spring. But in this instance, where we're really cleaning it up,
it looks so
makes a huge
good.
Difference, especially when you can see it in process and you see the portion that is versus the portion that's not.
Oh my gosh! I took a lot of photos of that, and it was just kind of a thing of we had so many messages at that time that we didn't put anything out about that yet, but. We'll share some images of that soon. Mm-hmm. And yeah, and the railings are all getting replaced now. Just certain mm-hmm. things have to be freshened up at certain periods of time. So lots of work like that. And of course, like I said, the legend work is being done as well. So there's going to be, I feel like every time our coaster crew goes to work on a coaster in an intensive way, it becomes a new coaster.
Yeah.
Would you agree with
for
that?
Sure.
Yeah. It's a new experience.
I feel like every year they do something, they do a small piece of track work, and like, I probably know that ride way too well now, but like, I know immediately when I come through that section, and still every time that, whenever they did that crossover over the lift hill, that section still, I mean, after that triple down, when they did that whole section, it feels like you're ice skating on the track. Mm-hmm. And I just, every time, like, I think I stop and applaud. There are probably pictures of me like applauding because I like chef's kissing because I'm like, oh my gosh, this is so good.
Yeah. Yep. It's a totally different ride.
Exactly. Every time they go through it. So, props to our coaster team.
They're amazing.
All right. So another one of the most frequently asked questions, and I'm going to put it to you guys first, just for the entertainment factor. Hey, Josh, when are we building our next coaster?
As soon as we can. Just
that's a good way to put it. I like that.
It's on the docket.
Yeah. No. Even as an enthusiast, I know you're always excited for that next big project, but I would say good 90% of the questions we get are, when's the next coaster coming?
Yeah. And it's always kind of like heartbreaking for us because we're like, it doesn't work that way. Mm-hmm. And also we don't belong to a giant network of other parks that, you know, we just have a rotation and it's our year for the coaster. Right. Like, that's not how it works here.
We are the network.
We are the network.
We are what we have.
Yeah.
I enjoy, especially on social media, that people will send us that on like Facebook through our inbox or something.
Or just randomly.
We're gonna spill the beans in just a private message to one person.
Right. Yes. Yeah.
Can
you keep a secret?
You can tell me. It doesn't have to be public.
I've joked before about crowdfunding a coaster. And just like, you know, if you donate like $1 million, we'll tell you the theme ahead of time or something like that. Like,
you can even decide the theme.
Yeah. That's true. For $1 million, you could, depending on what kind of coaster, or like $1 million, you can choose an element in the coaster or something like that.
There
and
you
for,
go.
You know, $10,000, you can know in advance and we'll punish you, you know, severely if you tell anybody.
Like how people have like brick projects where like you can get your name on a brick. Like, we'll put your name on a board for X amount. $1,000. You'll get your
it's
name.
Like, suddenly the coaster's name. Someone like donates a giant chunk of change. It's like the Joshinator.
I'm on board.
Like goes in like the Thanksgiving section. It's like, What? I don't know. People named Josh go to Thanksgiving dinner, Josh, don't they?
Josh was a famous pilgrim. Did you not know? He was an explorer.
There was Josiah and...
It's in the book.
Jebediah and Josh.
Yes, yes.
But yeah, Sabrina, how would you answer that question?
I usually laugh. I don't know, like when people ask me that.
That makes them feel better.
Well, it's like...
To
well,
ourselves, yeah. Not in like a mean way.
Yeah, because it's like, yeah. Like kind of with Josh, it's like, if we were holding that secret, do you think I would just like throw it out there? Like, I don't know. Or I'll try to turn it around and like, ooh, what would you add? Because I don't know, I'm always interviewing people and crowdsourcing what they want. But I'm just like, what would you add? Well, you know, what section would you add? What would you add to the birthday section since we've thrown that on the podcast? So I kind of like throw it around or I ask them their favorite part or I usually try to spin it around, but because I don't know how to answer it. Or I throw out the like, well, you know how things are and like Thanksgiving. And I throw out that answer of like, we're just trying to like spread the theming out more for now. And they're like, but when's the next coaster? I'm not deferring at all. Not avoiding your direct question at all.
Even lately, I point them back to the Hala blog of look what we're doing with the legend right now.
It's going to be a new ride.
How do you answer that one, Matt?
Well, I'm going to copy off of Josh. I think that's a good answer as soon as we can. I will say that's not something that we don't talk about frequently. Mm-hmm. You know, we're constantly brainstorming on what could be the next big thing. Mm-hmm. But the when is what we don't know. It's, you know, there's a lot of things that we have to work into a 5-year, 10-year, 15-year plan. And as 2020 taught us, those 5-year, 10-year plans can change very quickly. And what may have been planned in year 4 now is planned in year 9. You know, it's very fluid.
Yep.
So as soon as we can, I think is a good answer.
Yeah, I like that. And I want to add to kind of what Sabrina said, because I feel like normally my answer to anything of like, what's next? What's coming up? I'll always say, I can give you a couple hints. So here are the hints I'll tell you right now. First of all, the Pilgrim's Plunge area, I'm just going to tell you right now that we are not building a coaster there without a giant battle from me, because there's nothing else around it. Mm. And I don't build parking lot coasters. Sorry. Throwing a little shade there.
I mean, who does though?
We're not a parking we're not a parking lot coaster company. That's not what you come here for. We're not building, that's a wide open space. Yes, it would be very cheap and easy to build there. But I have no interest in that spot. Mm-hmm. So when you're making predictions and or recommendations to us, maybe keep that one in mind, that that's a deal breaker for me as I hear that one of like, I wanna hear you out. And I still listen to the type of coaster someone recommends and all of that, because I do believe that, you know, some enthusiasts really pay attention and really do want to make a recommendation that fits our park. Some people are just, you know, I believe there's one question here that really got me. And this was from Ethan Eichberger. Will you get a 500-foot RMC T-Rex themed to turkeys building a rocket to escape Thanksgiving? That one, I just adored the specificity of that.
Can it launch out of Gobbler Getaway? That's what it needs to do. The ultimate getaway.
That really
and
got
fly
me.
Fly through Plymouth Rock.
Yes, yes. I mean, just go right through.
Just even isn't that type of losing it right now. That was one I really did want to say for the entire group to experience, but we may bring that one back. Who knows?
That's a mouthful. Could you say that again?
A 500-foot RMC T-Rex themed to turkeys building a rocket to escape Thanksgiving.
It's just as funny the second time you say it.
Yeah.
I want to know the code name for the project.
The WOW project.
Thunder Chicken.
Because that's what I thought we said.
Thunder
WOW.
2.0. That would be funny if we had another bird theme ride, though, with the bird in the name.
We don't have enough.
Yeah, I love birds.
Yeah, since Matt loves birds so much, so fond of them.
My other thoughts are we're typically going to build for the family. So when you make your grand ride predictions and or, you know, try to make recommendations to us, again, we're always listening and we're always trying to find the kernel of what could be usable and think that over, because I don't own good ideas. That's not...
not the gatekeeper.
I don't think anybody here is the perfect purveyor. I mean, I've got a great theme idea for one very specific coaster and one very specific section that I'm not even going to give away because I actually think it could be a thing. Mm-hmm. So I'm very pumped about that one day. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the next decade, hopefully.
I mean, you did ask
for time and money.
Yeah, time and money, as Matt P says.
Time and money.
Wasn't Thunderbird your, like, graduation request?
That was my, yeah.
So, I mean, like, maybe just do...
It happened.
It happened.
Not when you graduated, yeah. But...
I wrote, this is a little preview of the 75 years book. I wrote something in there to the effect of, like, in a way it was very appropriate because it was our gift to Dad. Mm. Instead of his gift to us, it was our gift to Dad.
I love it.
Now I'm going to get a little choked up. It's fine. So anyway, recommendations. We're going to try and build for the family. So there's a time and a place for a Thunderbird. We love Thunderbird. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's definitely an argument for building things for that next, you know, age group in the family. And we definitely want to keep those families coming. So there's always going to be a place for that, but it's going to be pretty rare. Right now, what we're interested in is the things that can get the entire family on. And I'm going to add this. When we ask people what their favorite attraction is in the park, we hear some coasters, but mostly we hear Raging Rapids and Frightful Falls. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And what I hear from that is that people like to spend time with their family.
Yes.
Those are both rides that you can get some pretty, you know, smaller kids on. And they're fun. They're not like the highest thrill, but they're just a nice length ride. And it's just fun. Mm-hmm. You laugh a lot when people get splashed. It's just, yeah.
You don't
That's
have
the
to
kind
leave
of thing that, yeah.
The littles and the mammals at the exactly. watching from the blast area.
Some
you know?
Of those, a lot of those attractions, the big coasters and things like that, tend to split up the family. And right now we're very interested in things that, you know, can keep the family together as much as we possibly can. We still want to pack some punches and still build some, you know, a good mix of all rides. But
it's funny you say that, Sabrina, because growing up, that was like my kids and their grandma's favorite ride.
Yes.
Like, they would ride Raging Rapids. They would come to the park and ride like five times.
Yes. It's
in
one
between
of,
going to the shows.
I feel like that was one of, yes, that's what we do too. We'll do Raging Rapids and then you get your snack and you dry off while you watch the show.
It's and
like,
then go back to Raging Rapids when the show's over.
Yes. So and do it all again.
Right. It's like a cycle.
That's yep. always my mom's argument, and I know she listens. I love you. It's like she's like, no, we're dry, and I was like, exactly, we can ride it again because it's one that all of us can ride. And I just like, that's the one where like I'll never forget. I was riding as a family, Savannah's first time. She had my hands so tight that when we got off the ride, I had a little dry patch. And I'm like, I seriously would get that tattooed on my hand, like if that wouldn't be extremely painful.
Yeah,
but like
it would look kind of weird, too.
Yeah, it'd be weird. Yeah. No one else would get it.
Right.
Yeah.
But
what's
like
a big blotch on your hand?
What's that child-sized shape in your hand?
Aww.
But I just remember her little hand being so little and, like, squeezing. Yeah. And so it was just thrilling enough. Or she, now her goal is to ride Raven this year. Her sister rode it at seven. She's convinced she can grow. So this off-season. So.
You know, she has a goal.
I believe in the mind-body connection that, you know, like you tell yourself you're going to get sick, you're going to get sick.
Yeah.
So, you know, maybe if you can just will yourself tall enough.
She's, we'll find out.
How old is she right now?
She will be five next week. So
she might have another year.
She probably has another year. But if you're listening, keep eating your vegetables.
Yep, absolutely.
You can
willpower,
do it.
Veggies, yep, eat healthy. I'm trying to think. I feel like there was one more thing I was going to say. Oh, economical is the last tip I'll give you. We're not building the biggest, baddest thing. We're trying to build something that is unique, that packs a big, you know, bang for its buck. So I feel like that's a good list of recommendations of kind of the filters that we view new projects through. And if you're trying to make a guess in the future, one day when we are able to talk about a new attraction, I think that's a good way to think about that, and a good way that you can probably make some good guesses. Am I right?
Yep, you're right.
All righty. Let me see. I'm looking through the list right now. Of course, any plans to build any more roller coasters? I'm going to echo. I watched Tony Clark one time in an ACE event, and he said, there's always going to be another coaster. It's a matter of when, not if.
Time and money.
So it's all, there are going to be more roller coasters at Holiday World. Mm-hmm. It's just a matter of timing.
Do you like dipping your feet in water?
In the water park.
Do you like pushing buttons?
On ride control panels.
How about long walks on the beach?
Of our wave pools.
Or beautiful views?
From the top of coaster hills.
Do you have experience with cannonballing into pools?
I believe those are called compact jumps.
Do you have experience buckling seatbelts?
That one kind of speaks for itself.
This summer, pick the job that creates memories and fun for you, coworkers, and our guests. The attractions department offers positions for ride operators, slide attendants, and lifeguards.
Our slogan is two parks, one team, one mission. That mission is to be a safety and efficiency-driven team offering top-notch operations at two world-class parks.
Come join the attractions team at Holiday World and Splash and Safari.
We want you to be part of our attractions family.
Want to make a suggestion? Or have questions for the Pod Squad? There are more ways than ever to reach out to the podcast.
Find at Holiday World on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, and use the hashtag HOWOPO to let us know you're talking about us.
You can now call us. Dial 812-937-4401 and type in extension 8081 to get to the HOWOPO voicemail box.
Leave your questions and feedback for us there, or you can email us at podcast@holidayworld.com. either with a written message or with a voice memo.
Again, reach out on social media to @HolidayWorld and use the hashtag HOWOPO or call us at 812-937-4401, extension 8081, or send us an email to podcast@holidayworld.com.
Are you an entertainer or a sound tech? Love to sing, dance, act, or all of the above? Then the Entertainment Crew may be perfect fit for you. We're looking for costume characters and sound technicians for our shows. Join the Costume Character Crew and help bring our mascots to life. Never performed before? That's okay. We have specialized training for our team members. Check out our jobs page for more details.
Our Holiday World, and we love holidays. All right, January 17th is Ditch New Year's Resolutions Day. Did you guys start with resolutions this year?
I stopped doing that years ago because it was pointless. I just disappointed myself every time. So it's like, why set myself up for failure?
Yeah.
I feel like I try to keep things throughout the year. Like, I'm more of a quarterly goal kind of gal. Like, I don't know, like the end of the year, I'd like to be healthy-ish. Like the ballpark. Like, I never set like a weight goal, but like, I like to be close to what I started the year and like move 30 minutes a day. Like, that's my kind of resolution. So, but those have been the same for like 5 years. So
nice.
I don't think I'm like more of a, this is what I'd like, where this is where I want to be at the end of the year instead of a resolution.
No, I know you.
So then you don't
like
have to
run.
Do it in January. You can wait until December to like cram it all in.
Yeah, if I'm feeling.
If you feel the pressure.
Yeah, if I'm like, the weight gate that found me.
I'm not eating for the next 42 days.
Oh my gosh!
You'll find me on the treadmill. It's fine.
I used to set a resolution. Well, for a long time, I didn't set resolutions. For several years, though, I did like a book a month. Just because I can be very inconsistent about reading, and or like I also count audiobooks because, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
I have a world of, you know, I have to clean things and launder things at some point. So that helps. But I feel like I still end up like I go for like months and months without reading things. And then I like binge like 10 books in 1 week.
Yes.
And then I'm like, oh no.
Yep.
And then I realized like I come up for air in the outside world and I'm like, oh.
Yep.
You've neglected the world around you during that time.
I gotta get back to life.
I have no clothes. The dishes are a mountain. Yeah. Where's Matt?
So I had a friend who told me that like a book a month was like her like gauge of balance, because her reading is self-care for her. And so she's like, if I'm reading a book a month, that's a good pace for me. That probably means that I'm not letting a bunch of other stuff go by, you know, consuming my life to this book or like with this book, but I'm still getting my reading in. So I try to make that a goal, but I need to make it more of an actual paced goal, not a
Do you do fun reading? This is where I struggle. Like, I go between pleasure reading and personal development reading, because I love reading personal development books. I just started a John C. Maxwell book that's like, it's everyone communicates, not everyone, or few connect. That's what it is. Mm. It's really good so far. I'm not sure where it's going to go, but I have that going, and then a fun book on audiobook.
Nice.
I'm like, I'm going to try that balance of like the professional development, because I'm going to want to take notes and focus, but then the pleasure reading. Like, I'd be interested to see what our listeners say about that. Like, do you guys, what kind of blend of do you do?
Send us an email at podcast@holidayworld.com or tweet at us with #HoWoPo. Well,
send us reading suggestions.
Yeah. Or send us your resolutions and whether or not you've stuck to them so far.
We won't judge.
Yep. But no, I'm with you, though, after that tangent, on I like to have like my fun books, except like I went down like a very big mystery, like thriller hole this last year via audiobook, and it got to the point where I was like locking every door every time I like walked inside and was like getting very like moody and angry and was like, oh my gosh, I've got to stop this right now.
That's how I got reading Gone Girl.
Yeah.
Like my husband would say something. I'm like, give him like, you can't see this. This is a podcast, but I'm like staring at him. Yeah. Like, are you gonna like kill me? Like, and like, you know,
or
just
pretend
and hide me or it's, yeah, I have to be careful about what I read.
Josh, how about you? Resolutions?
I typically decide what I want to do in the new year in mid, like, December. I very fervently avoid setting something I will start January 1st.
That's smart.
I know there's the whole, you'll fall out of it. And it's more of a gradual thing. So I think kind of like what Sabrina was saying, like, I want to do it a little bit of a change and then work up to something. I think people typically set goals that are very aggressive and think they can stick to them right from the start. So it's all about the gradual changes.
Yep. So you guys don't have New Year's resolutions, you have next year resolutions.
Yeah. Yes. Sure.
I also will say that I got like a little habit tracker thing. This was like 2 years ago. It's got like coffee spills on it and everything. But I broke that out this year because I'm, you know, we're less than 80 days to the wedding now. So
coming in hot.
Feeling a little pressure, but I'm like, oh, I'd like to be a little more active come wedding time and like not necessarily like lose weight, but just feel a little healthier than I do right now. And I've got some holiday weight hanging on right now. So, but yeah, that little habit tracker this time around has worked out very nicely for me. Up until me getting a cold that kept me off the office for 7 days straight.
That'll do that.
But even then, I was, I knew I was going to have to fill in a block.
I didn't want you to be sick, but I appreciated you being out of the office while you were sick.
Yeah. I definitely was like, nobody needs this. Also, I hit a point where I was like, I can't work for longer than like 2 hours a day right now.
I feel like that's kind of a positive, a silver lining of COVID. Like, we all learned how to work from home. So if you don't feel good, like a lot
just
of...
stay home.
Just stay home. Like, don't push through it. Don't spread it around.
Don't bring it to me.
Yeah.
I don't want it.
I was happy to confirm it was not COVID, but yeah.
Yeah. And
it's still...
It's just, I don't know. I feel like that's a healthy self-care thing that we've all learned. Like, you know, take a little bit of a slower morning. You're still going to get your stuff done.
Exactly.
So, Matt, were you more happy that Leah stayed home for her own health or the fact that you share a wall with her in the office?
In an air vent.
I will say yes.
All right, moving on. January 17th is also National Kid Inventors Day. I did a deep dive on this one. I learned that Benjamin Franklin was a kid inventor.
Oh, really? Cool.
And so what's the age break for a kid in their mind?
I feel like it's mostly like under 18 because they were talking about some like developments by 17-year-olds. And of course, they have all left my head now because colds, am I right? But
you're on the spot.
I highly recommend you to check out daysoftheyear.com, the National Kid Inventors Day. I learned a lot of inventions were created by young people. So. Bum, 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 bum. All right.
Makes me feel very unaccomplished.
I know. Right.
And when I was a kid, I loved taking things apart but not putting them back together. So my mom would literally give me like radios and computers, old ones, and I would just take them apart.
Because you thought you were going to do something great with it and then it just didn't happen?
That's right. Like I would just piece it together, like the radio and the computer parts together and just make like little designs of things.
And then
things.
Nothing worked.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. But you tried.
It wasn't even a functional thing. It was like... I thought I was making art or something. It was, it just went to the trash.
Maybe you did.
Yeah, I still have, the 1 year they gave me a toolbox with tools for Christmas.
Nice.
And I still have that toolbox.
Nice.
It's got my little kid's handwriting on it, Sabrina Harper now. Yeah, so.
That's so sweet. What was I? I just remember, like, this, honestly, National Kid Inventors Day reminded me of Matt, you'll probably be too old for this. Did you guys ever watch Slime Time Live on Nickelodeon?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
They always had a kid inventor.
Yeah, I'm too old for that.
Well, and like your kids are probably not quite old enough for that either.
No, I don't think so.
So it was like this like quiz show where like this like panel of like their all that, which was like kids
SNL.
Mm-hmm. They tried to guess things about these like kids and like tried to figure out like what this kid invented. Like at the end of the show, it was like, what did this kid invent?
So was the panel other kids or was it adults?
It was adults, like young adults, like actors and comedians trying to guess this thing. And like they got slimed randomly throughout it. It was a whole thing. It was always like...
It was like a pudding jello mixture type stuff that fell on their heads.
Hmm. So, yeah. Yep.
The glory days of Nickelodeon right there.
Classic kids comedy right there. Just dump green goo on an adult and we'll always crack up. But yeah, so at the end of it though, the kids would like come out and like show their like weird human trick, but there were like a lot of kid inventions as well. And honestly, well, there was also one where like a girl let her dog drink milk out of her mouth. That was very upsetting. That stays with me every day of my life. And wow. Now it'll stay with you guys too.
The gift that keeps on giving.
She was like, it's acting like it was like a trick she her dog. And I'm like, no, I'm pretty sure if you give a dog an opportunity, they would happily do that at any point. But anyway.
Hard pass.
Yeah, truly.
Matt loves dogs.
I feel like watching the kids
more
always
than birds.
Have, yeah. The kids always had some like funky inventions too. And like, that was when I was like, yeah, I'll never be a kid inventor.
Yeah.
I watched that and was like, nah, that won't be me.
That's just gross.
I'll just write. We'll be good there. Anyway, moving on. January 18th is National Thesaurus Day. I feel like it's been a long time since I've broken out a thesaurus, but like, I don't know about you guys. I still use thesaurus.com a lot.
Mm-hmm. Or
Google. Google. What's like, another word for this?
Synonym. For
you highlight it. Is it? Shift F7. Yes, I do Shift F7 all the time.
On like Word and
yes.
Nice.
Yep.
That's yeah, that's favorite. True. The Microsoft Office like thesaurus tool is very handy as well. But sometimes when it gets limited, I still go to the full thesaurus.com.
You know, there's the Friends episode where Joey tries to write a letter of recommendation for Monica and Chandler for the adoption.
Parents, yeah.
And it ended up sounding like a two-year-old wrote it because he used a thesaurus on every word.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
I'm trying to remember. Like, he at one point said that they had like, was trying to say they have large hearts and it was like blood pumping muscles. Yeah. Something like that.
Engorged blood pumping muscles or something like that. Yeah.
Great, great. But anyway, love my thesaurus. Take the day. Appreciate it. Use a word that you'd never used before because the thesaurus recommended it to you. January 19th is National Popcorn Day. Museum Selfie Day. I want to call out Nell and the Santa Claus Museum and Village.
Nice.
I don't think they're open to the public. Are they open to the public?
I don't think so, no.
But still, when you're there, take a museum selfie and remember January 19th. Mm-hmm. It's also my mom's birthday and Dolly Parton's birthday.
Savannah Cates.
And Savannah Cates.
I was trying to remember your mom. I can't remember if it was Savannah or Madeline that one of them had a birthday.
But yeah, National Popcorn Day. Are you guys going to celebrate? That's like.
We literally, I'm not lying. I think we have popcorn at my house every single day. My kids are obsessed with popcorn.
Mm-hmm.
That was my everyday after school snack.
That's like, pretty
I'd get like
kids.
A mini bag of popcorn and that was, yeah. Now I have an air popper.
Ooh, that's fun.
I experiment in the world of, I found some truffle oils and truffle popcorn at home now.
Yeah, Drew's already stressing because we think he's going to have to get braces in like 6 months.
Oh, no.
So I told him, I'm like, you're not going to be able to eat popcorn anymore. He said, I will. They can't stop me. I'm like, I'm paying for your braces so I can stop you. You're not going to eat it. He said, you won't see me doing it.
Oh, my gosh.
Okay, we'll have this argument.
You're just going to like smell the smell of popcorn at home and be like, Drew?
Yeah, exactly.
He's already planning on bucking the orthodontist. So.
Oh, great.
I did.
We're off to a good start.
I did. Yeah. You know what?
He said, and I'm going to chew gum.
I said, sugar-free.
Let's just stop having this conversation. I don't want to talk anymore.
I did a lot of things you shouldn't do with braces, but Yeah. I mean, my justification was the first time I had them was I was like in fifth grade and I had headgear. It was a whole thing.
Oh, wow.
Because I had an underbite. And so they had to like expand my like skull.
Did you just wear that at like night when you slept?
Yeah. I just had to wear it at night. But yeah, it was like I did not like I followed the rules on that time. And then I got them again in high school. And like that was always part of the plan. But by the time I hit that in high school, I was like, no, I've done this.
Yeah.
I followed the rules once.
What's the worst that could happen?
We're all good. I never popped a bracket. I never did anything like that. So
that's why I feel awful in high school. Like I feel like I did pretty good. I don't really chew gum anyway. Popcorn I ate and was fine. My poor sister now has braces as an adult. And she like breaks a bracket like all the time.
Yeah.
Like I don't know, like if she's just living recklessly.
Our
like,
girls both broke brackets a couple times.
So yeah. I never broke a single one. Like I don't know. Maybe we just got lucky or they did them super tight. But she's like, I don't know what to do. I'm like, I don't know what you're doing. Like,
yeah. I don't. Yeah. But I feel like that's a thing that I've heard. I feel like adults or I don't know, older kids break their. I don't know. But anyway. I'm a popcorn fan. Josh, are you a popcorn fan?
Yeah, I don't need a holiday to celebrate with popcorn.
Exactly. Right.
That's every like day.
I don't need anybody to tell me what day to celebrate. That's fair. January 20th is National Cheese Lovers Day.
Hmm.
I'm assuming everyone at the table is a cheese fan already.
Yep.
Do you have a favorite type of cheese?
I like all cheeses, quite honestly.
I really like sharp cheddar, and Aldi has... It's like cinnamon goat cheese with cranberries on it. It's very good. Mm. Very good. It's a, like in their like charcuterie board section of cheeses.
I'm kind of with Matt. I'm an equal opportunity lover of all types of cheese. Favorite form would be anything hot that I can dip a chip in.
Yes.
That's fair.
That's a good one.
Yeah, I'm trying to think of like is there like
a dish with cheese or something like that too that's like your favorite? Steven, do you have thoughts on cheese?
I was just going to say whatever's on my plate.
Yeah.
Have you been to the Melting Pot? Like they have those all over? Like,
I haven't.
Oh, you need to go to the Melting Pot then.
I bet Chicago has one.
Oh, sounds good.
Yeah, there's one in Louisville too.
Is there?
Yeah.
Huh.
Super good.
This is one of those moments where I'm like, Matt and I only go to steakhouses, like, ever.
It's over
and
near,
I have
like,
to, like,
the,
break him out of his world to get him out of a steakhouse.
It's, like, near the St. Matthews area.
Okay.
That's so what I'm saying, like...
Swing him by Cheesecake Factory and get him plain cheesecake, which is so boring.
We had Cheesecake Factory the other day, and he had the chocolate mousse cheesecake.
What?
Ooh. Yeah.
Did he not explode?
Gross.
I know, right?
Did the pyramid explode from the expansion? Make way, make way.
I know.
That's still a pain point for me with him. It's like... How can you just like plain cheesecake?
I know. I don't get it. I don't.
Nothing against plain cheesecake like it too. But when you have that many options.
Yeah. I was going to call out the cheesecake. That's also a cheese.
It's a cheese.
It is a cheese.
Right. Cream cheese. Yeah. For sure.
I love cream cheese.
I think they're playing cheesecake related day. So I think we're safe in the saving celebration on that one.
Okay.
I will call out that burrata has become my favorite in recent years. I once saw it described as mozzarella for bougie jerks.
That's awesome.
That checks. So. but I recommend that with a little like bruschetta or a little, I don't know, burrata goes with anything. I fell in love with it when someone made like this little like appetizer with like shaved Brussels sprouts with like lemon juice and like pancetta, like, cooked pancetta on top and then like a little thing of burrata on top on like a little crostini. And I was like, why is this so good? What gave you the right to do this?
Right.
So anyway, burrata, incredible. Let's see. January 20th is also National Camcorder Day, which I just needed to call out. Like, does anyone still have a camcorder?
I think we do in our closet that's not been used in like 15 years.
We have a GoPro. Yeah. I don't know if that counts as a camcorder. It feels
like that's today's camcorder.
Yeah.
Everybody's got a camera on them now with their phone.
I know. Yeah.
Yep. That was weird. Like when you get a kid, like I felt like that was a thing you should have. Like, how are you going to document? Well, I have a phone in my pocket. Like, but I felt the pressure to have a device to record the memories on. But I just use my phone most of the time.
So I remember back when like the flip became a thing, that was going to be the thing that replaced the camcorder. Do you guys remember this? It was like the size of like a cell phone today, length and like height and width wise, but not depth wise. Like it was like an inch or two thick. It had like a really tiny screen on it, and like it had like the USB port already like in it. You just pulled it out and plugged it in. It was a whole thing, and I was all excited about it. And I got one, and I even like went to one of my journalism classes. Someone who worked at Google came and talked to us, and he was like, "This is the future." He pulls out his flip, and I was like, "This is so cool." And then like 2 years later, it was on our phone. Alrighty. We've only made it through like 4 days. January 21st is International Sweatpants Day.
Hey.
I feel like I will be celebrating accordingly.
Ironic that comes after National Cheese Lovers Day.
Mm-hmm. It's also National Granola Day, so maybe it's like, you're going to need to make a change to your diet.
I like it's also National Squirrel Appreciation Day. And that just makes me want to give a shout out to all the park squirrels who are living their best lives right now in the park.
Oh, like, my gosh.
The return. Like
I saw, I'm not kidding you, the fattest squirrel in the park this year. I was like, bruh, you got to lay off the funnel cake, man. You can't do that.
Well, he won't have them now until May, so maybe he'll work it off.
Probably, well,
that's his New Year's resolution.
I think about that squirrel right now because I'm like, I wonder if like for hibernation time, if he was like panicking all of a sudden. Because he hasn't been gathering nuts. He's been like eating funnel cake. Like,
so now he's like, oh, crud. What am I going to do now?
I worry about that squirrel.
The squirrel's got diabetes and he's like looking for nuts. And he's
so appreciate that squirrel.
Yeah.
Yes.
Shout out to him.
Poor squirrel. I hope he's making it. Okay.
Hopefully he packed some funnel cake back. He ate some.
Maybe hibernation is like diet time for him and he'll be back. Anyway, January 22nd is National Answer Your Cat's Questions Day. And I just needed to call out every cat related holiday. There's so many.
So many.
Why do we need to answer our cat's questions?
Now, is it also, all what are the cat's
questions?
Colors?
What kind of questions could they possibly have?
How would this look on the ground?
There you go. There's your
answer. That to me is like the only question cats ask. Or like, what would it be like if my human died and I ate it?
Yeah.
That's what I was
thinking. I'm always like, convinced cats are going to ready to eat you.
That was my thing. They're probably saying, thinking, how many ways could I kill you?
Yeah.
Sorry to cat owners.
That's what I feel like they're thinking when they look at you. Like, yeah. I am thinking of ways to kill you right now.
Why does this stupid human keep putting ornaments on the Christmas tree?
Yeah. Yeet.
Also, sorry to cat owners and cat lovers.
Yeah, I don't like cats either. Still, like,
don't come after us, PETA. I feel like our cat, the only time she gives me attention is if I'm like giving my husband a hug because she's very territorial of him. And the only time she like immediately will come out of nowhere.
Like hiss at you?
Yeah, no, she'll just like come up and like no
claws.
Let
you know she's watching?
Yeah, she'll either stand and look and watch or she'll like come up and like tap me like excuse me, that's my man.
Back off.
May I cut in?
Yeah.
May I have the stance?
He wants his real woman now. Excuse me. She's funny. She's got such a personality. The only time she really talks is if she's hungry, lonely, or thirsty, which is relatable. So but she'll come up and like she finds you, or she will like if I take a bath, she sits on the edge with her little paws and watches me. And it's like she's testing the water. She like paddles at it. Like that's our only interaction with her. And she hides 95% of the time.
There you go. Like
those cats are okay.
Yeah. And and her brother lives at my grandma's house and he's like ridiculous and like sprints around the house and knocks off all, she collects like all these porcelain things and knocks them off and yeets himself off the top of his cat tower into her like china cabinet. Like he's like something else. But like we have, I'm like, grandma's like, dude, what did your cat do? I'm like, she slept today. Yeah. I don't know. Like, and they're like, well, was she excited at night? No, she slept all night. Like, I don't know. Like, she's just special. But
she's special.
I had a friend who had a cat. Like, I went over to her place once, maybe twice. And just that cat was seriously the biggest. It's like favorite pastime was knocking things off the counter.
Yeah.
And it just like, truly, I'm like, I've met plenty of other really chill cats, but that one stays in my mind now. Of like, it just like literally would like make eye contact with you and then like, bam, off the counter it went. And it was just like, she was constantly like, as she was cooking, like moving things around. I'm like making all these wild gestures right now, like picking up a cup and setting it up. And then he was going up. And so she was taking the cup back down. And I'm like, that's exhausting. That's how do you work. Live? That's, I don't know.
Sounds like my grandma's cat Tom was the same spirit, because like he will just run across her stove and I'm like her tech person and we're neighbors also, and she's like, can you come help with my stove? I don't know what Sabbath mode is, but Tom has the stove locked, and it was locked and like we had to like unplug it from the wall, like pull it out, like my dad had to get involved with like getting it unlocked.
That's when you get rid of the cat.
And see, she's like, but he'll starve. I'm like, he has enough energy to hunt. He would be. I actually asked the vet. I was like, I think we need to like, either grandma's going to need medicine for her anxiety or the cat needs something because he needs to chill out. And she's like, he would probably be really happy if she set him free. Like obviously in a safe environment, like not, she lives in a subdivision, probably not there, but you know, like my parents' farm where he came from. But oh yeah, he's the same way. He like, yeah.
I feel, I have also met a cat that just belonged outdoors, and like my friend, I actually helped rehome that cat to a place that had a little more wide open space.
Yes.
Because she was moving and she was like, I can't take the cat with me. But yeah, I think that cat is much happier now here, in like wide open spaces. All right. January 23rd is National Handwriting Day. This was going to be one where I baited Matt because he has terrible handwriting.
It stresses me out. Are you Matt B or me?
Well, Matt B, I was going to bait with this, but
I print everything because it gives me a lot of stress, because I go back to fifth grade. That was the first B+ I ever got, was in cursive.
Are you left-handed?
No, I'm right-handed.
You're right-handed.
But I got a B+, and that still haunts me to this day, like fifth grade. Like, right, I was devastated.
You had a good run.
I did. And I know B+ isn't bad, but
I feel like I've told this story before.
Me.
Yeah.
But I held up my entire second grade class from learning cursive.
Even teach cursive now in school.
Yeah. But there's me and one other student that had such bad handwriting that they were like, you have to get better at printing before I will let you
do cursive.
Whoa. And I think the problem was I just had like so many ideas. I was really excited. And so I like wrote everything down as fast as I could. They sent me home with like worksheets. I never did them. And they were like, I can tell you've been working on this. This looks so much better. And I'm like, yeah, I know how to write well. You literally just had to say like,
slow down.
Hey, your handwriting is awful. I can't read it. You didn't have to hold up the entire class over it.
Your dad had horrific handwriting.
Oh yeah.
Horrific. Oh,
like I said, you can tell when I am calmly thinking, like, you know, planning out my day or something like that versus when I'm like brainstorming, because like I can't read my own brainstorming notes.
I can
make out like a letter and like some other stuff, but like it's not even like cursive or print that I write when I'm like fully brainstorming mode. I'm just like, I just gotta get this on paper because there's another idea coming after this, and I gotta get that one down on paper too.
I feel like you write like a lefty though. Like,
I do.
You're right-handed, but like how a lot of lefties kind of like over rotate their hand. Yeah. Like Leah kind of writes.
I used to write. I think I learned to write this way. I am, you know, visual gags on a podcast. Am I right? I used to like hook my arm around and like, I think I was trying to cover my paper. I think like this, I truly think this came out of me just being like a kind of a precocious and obnoxious child who didn't want, was convinced people were all trying to copy my answers. And so I wrapped my arm around. So I'm like making like a right angle with my
elbow
here, and then wrapping my hand around. So I've gotten it around to like here where I stick my elbow out like at like a 45 degree angle, and like, you know, not arm straight out at a 90 degree, but you know, it's better.
Yeah.
But everybody still looks at me and goes, I didn't know you were a lefty. And I go, put my hands up, and they're like, oh no, you write like a lefty.
Yeah. Well, I actually thought of you. Madeline's class is learning cursive right now, which I was excited because, like,
hey,
I don't know if that's
kids
like
do learn cursive, Matt.
I don't know if that's like a public school versus private like school. Yeah. I don't know.
That's
maybe
surprising.
And honestly, like, I was shocked when she's like, we get to learn cursive, and I was like, oh, that's awesome. Yeah. but she was holding it, and Madeline was kind of over-rotating her hand. And I was like, I wonder if Leah's good at cursive. I'm like, oh, what about left-handed people? Because, like, the way cursive goes, that would be awkward, like, to mm-hmm. push a pin that way. I don't know. I'm right-handed, so I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. I
gotta think about it. You usually print, don't you, when you do notes?
Yeah, and I'm the same. If I've got a lot of thoughts running, my handwriting becomes essentially unreadable.
Yes.
Can you read it, though?
I can usually decipher it enough to figure it out again.
Yeah.
It's fine.
I'm with you, yeah.
We just did our...
Occasionally, I truly have no idea. But generally, then I can go down the path and figure out other words
what
and go...
in the middle of this?
And like retrace my line of thinking, because my line of thinking seems to always go... to say, like, seriously, back when I was in the MBA program and I'd listen to the podcast, I was like in an episode of the podcast and I would listen to it, which is rare because I hate my voice, I would sit there and like laugh at exactly the same time, and I would like say, oh, I should have said, and then I'd say the thing that I actually thought I should have said and was like, oh no, I did say that.
I did say that. That's awesome. Yeah. I started doing the dot journaling, like mm-hmm. my books, I really like dots or squares. Mm-hmm. And when I started doing that, I started being more conscious about like the shapes of letters and fitting in the box, like making it work in the box, like mm-hmm. making it geometric. So like, I feel like my letters used to be really long and skinny, mm-hmm. but now they're more like squatty. I don't mm-hmm. know.
Squatty.
Yes. They're squatty letters.
But yeah. Yep. I also had one person on an airplane one time. I had like a grid journal, like a graphing paper journal, who like I was like writing out ideas for a paper and like obviously rapid brainstorming. And like then I don't care about boundaries of, you know, mm-hmm. lines and things like that. Nothing can hold me back. And he like looks over my shoulder and he goes, you know, they make other types of paper. I like clearly was annoying him by writing like large and across line. Like I was writing at a diagonal even. Mm-hmm. And I feel like he was like something in his brain was like, oh my God, stop.
Stop
judging me.
And yeah, I'm sitting there like, bro, I couldn't care less what you think of me. Right. I don't know what to tell you.
It makes sense. We just did our year in review process and I went through my calendar to kind of see like, oh, what did we do this year? And going through my notes, you're just like, huh?
Yeah.
Like the notes we have working in a theme park on your desk just they're a little different than mm-hmm. most office settings. So it's fun to like, you're like horses.
Cookie pick.
Yes, what? Exactly. Why was I? Okay. Green beans, question mark. What was that? So it's kind of fun to go back and look.
Let's see. January 24th is National Peanut Butter Day. I just needed to call that out for all the peanut butter lovers who are the fanatics are not at the table right now.
Right?
Lauren, Matt, Nell.
I like peanut butter. I wouldn't say I'm a fanatic.
Yeah, I know. I'm not like a... Yeah. I feel like I eat peanut butter like 4 or 5 times a year, unless it's like, you know, prominently in a bunch of desserts of some sort. But like, yeah, I don't break out a jar of peanut butter, but like twice a year.
Oh, we eat a lot of peanut butter at our house. I have one kid that likes peanut butter and one kid that likes jelly, though. So if you make sandwiches, there are no peanut butter jelly sandwiches in our house. It is
just jelly sandwiches.
Jelly
and peanut butter.
And then there's me who like eat anything. So
yeah, we'll get there.
Yeah. Growth.
Yep.
It'll be fun.
January 25th is National Opposite Day. Just want everyone to make a note of that one. You know, I don't know how you celebrate that day, but I'm more so just giving you a warning to watch out for other people who think they're being clever by celebrating that day.
I feel like I'm transported back to elementary school.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Like wearing your clothes backwards and stuff.
Oh, gosh.
Socks.
Yes. Oh, my gosh. Well, and I feel like you just randomly declared any day opposite day. So, mm-hmm. like, I don't know. But, you know, just warning everybody. Or if you want to make your kid that kid at school, you know, tell them to go celebrate opposite day. They'll have a blast. January 26th is National Peanut Brittle Day.
Yum.
Anybody going to celebrate? Crack a bracket?
Yeah, that's one. I love peanut butter, but like... And I
don't
like
peanut brittle.
I don't like what it does to your teeth after.
We'll say I like peanut butter, but I don't like peanuts.
Here's what I'm going to say on this one.
I know, it's
okay.
Weird.
That's fair, though.
Silver Dollar City has some of the best peanut brittle, and they also have something called Fool's Gold, which is like just toffee.
Oh,
so
it's like
that.
Light and airy. Uh-huh. I don't know how they do it. I don't know what it is, but like every time we go to Silver Dollar City, my mom's like, just pick up a little of that. Pick up a little. Just give me some fool's gold.
That's cool.
So if you find yourself at Silver Dollar City, I recommend on, well, frankly, any of their candy in their shops, but that fool's gold is pretty good. Now watch, they've like discontinued it. like David and the curly fries. All right. January 27th is National Chocolate Cake Day. You guys chocolate cake fans?
I am.
I'm in.
Don't we have a chocolate cake with like chocolate fudge frosting here?
Possibly at Marketplace.
I think at Marketplace we do now.
Mm-hmm. It was very good. You really can't go wrong with any of the cake in Marketplace.
You really can't. No.
Like the rainbow cake is good.
Yeah. Foods have stepped that up big time in the past few years.
So good.
I also wanted to call this one out very specifically because I have bridal showers coming up and wedding things coming up, and everyone keeps asking me about all these like obscure flavors now because there's always a trendy flavor of cake. And I'm a very much like, give me a white cake with buttercream frosting. Like that's all I want in life. Yeah. I want simple. Don't give me, like, they were asking about like carrot cake and like lemon curd at one point. And I was like, I didn't realize this, but I agree with Matt B. He takes a very strong stance. He goes on a rant about why fruit should not be in dessert.
That's what I was
thinking. He hates it when he has someone, well, and vegetables too.
So no carrot cake or lemons.
Yeah. And I love lemons.
I love carrot cake.
Yeah, me too.
I'll squeeze a lemon into like my water all the time. I used to like eat lemons as a kid. Like just lemons.
Yeah.
Love it. Love anything high acidity. I also like, it's probably connected to the fact that I've never smelled very well. Cause I also did a lot of like jalapenos and stuff as a kid. Like those extremes and like spice and acid have always spoken to me. But yeah. I truly despise lemon and dessert. Like, yeah. I'm just like, I was trying to be nice about it and be like, lemon and dessert isn't my favorite. But I just, everyone feels like they have to counteract the lemon and add like a bucket of sugar. And I'm like, no, let the lemon be a lemon.
Yeah.
It's delicious on its own.
So there will not be strawberry cheesecake or lemon cheesecake at the wedding.
No.
That's what you're saying.
No. And in general, yeah, I'm like, the wedding will probably have white cake,
yeah,
with buttercream icing.
I appreciate that. We had pie.
Ooh, that's fun.
One of my college roommates did that too. I thought that was a neat idea. Mm-hmm. Like 15 different kinds of pies. Mm-hmm. Like it was the way they arranged it was really cool too.
We had a chandelier, an old chandelier, and we put antique plates on each one of the little chandelier things.
Oh, cool.
That's cool.
And then put it on there because my husband doesn't like cake. He doesn't like icing, so.
What?
We did. I know. And we're married. That's like there's a person who likes icing and a person who doesn't like icing, and they get married. And our kids are the same way. Savannah will sit there and eat a container of icing. But Madeline literally decorated a cupcake and said, "Here you go." I was like, "It's yours." She's like, "No, I don't like sweet stuff." And I was like, "What? What?"
So, I birthed you.
Exactly. So, but
yeah,
it's fun when you make it your day, not what other people tell you to do.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, so I'm pro chocolate cake. I'm pro vanilla cake. End of list. January 28th is National Fun at Work Day. I feel like every time I see that one, it reminds me of the day that we got out the cheetah chase boat in the office.
With the VR.
That was a blog. Did that happen before you got here?
It did. It was actually, I was like researching the company and stuff.
And you still interviewed
And I saw that and I was like, well, I'm going to have questions about that. But I was like, I'm interested in taking pictures like that. So... Yep, it was like the blog post that was up whenever I was interviewing.
So the backstory is we had a town hall one day where we were talking about Cheetah Chase, and we showed off the boat. We had the boat all inflated and everything. And we had a VR headset that we had just gotten so that our sales reps could take it out and, you know, people could, you know, take a ride on a show floor of Cheetah Chase. And so we were playing with that. And then we had the boat upstairs, and people were sitting in the boat just testing it for comfort. And Eric came up with the VR headset, and we started combining that experience. And then at some point, a fan got broken out. And so we had multiple people sitting with our two VR headsets in there. With a fan blowing on them. And at one point, I believe someone like started spraying you with water.
Yes. I think a spray bottle was involved.
A spray bottle.
I was getting misted. So.
That was not accurate.
Welcome to Hollywood.
So,
yeah.
Is that safe to spray someone with a VR headset on?
I love through it. So.
No one does. That's
fine.
Good.
It's fine.
Yeah, if you can't have fun working here, where can you have fun?
Yeah, exactly.
You
know?
Yep.
I feel like we have to celebrate a little bit of a delay personally. If we don't have fun in the park, it's got to be a little bit later in the year.
Yeah. Right. True. Yeah. Right. Let's see. January 29th is Curmudgeon's Day. called that one out for me.
They probably don't want that day.
Yes.
It's the day that you go annoy the curmudgeons by being extra nice to them.
Stop giving me this day.
It's also National Puzzle Day, which I need to call out because I'm a puzzle fiend. I don't know about you guys.
I love puzzles. Yeah.
Like mental puzzles and just jigsaw puzzles.
Yep.
Mm.
Thoughts? Do you guys, are you puzzle people?
I do. I enjoy puzzles as long as, this sounds awful, as long as I'm good at it and it's coming fairly quickly. Like the really hard ones, I'm like, this is dumb. Puzzles are stupid. Like I can't.
You slap it off the table.
I just put it in the book and never to be done again. Like in the same way with like brain puzzles, like Sudoku or however you say it, I enjoy those until they get like past my ability and then I'm like, this is not good. Like
rip the page out
that
way.
Yes, literally. So I know that's not a healthy response. I'm working on that, but that's just how my brain is.
I've been a Sudoku kick on an app on my phone, and like I will say that when I get into those hard games, I'm like totally like, yeah, I'll watch an ad for another hint.
Yeah.
Like yep. I can't stand this anymore. Just get me out of this game.
Yep.
I will agree. Josh?
Yeah, no, with actual puzzles, I'm in for about 5 minutes and then I just kind of lose interest. I think it's much more, the word puzzles or stuff like that.
Yeah.
So even right now, you know, Wordle is giant on Twitter and I didn't know what it was. And now every morning I get up, it's the first thing I do. So
nice.
Never even heard of it.
You sent me that you were telling me about it. And I'm like, I need to investigate
it. It's on Twitter?
What is this again?
It's on Twitter. So it's
Twitter has games.
It's not, people post, I don't know how you phrase it, the way they solved the puzzle on Twitter. Okay. So it's a five-letter word. So you guess a five-letter word. If you get a right letter, but it's in a wrong spot, it shows up as yellow. If you get a right letter in the right spot, it shows up as green, and you get six attempts to try to figure out what the word is. Hmm. I mean,
it's kind of a cross between that like code-breaking game Mastermind and Hangman. So it's kind of like, but you get like five or six tries to do it. And it's an interesting take on a word game because you start with zero clues and you have to figure out what the five-letter word is in only six tries.
I've gotten really deep into like Twitter threads about strategies and which is the best first word. I mean, I was literally reading a thread that said that people use the word ado as their starting word because it's got so many vowels in it and they can start sort of piecing the word together.
That's smart.
It's all about the strategy behind it too.
I don't really get Twitter, so I probably would never be able to figure that out.
See, I like Twitter these days. Like if you need something, information pretty fast. Especially sports. It's a little frustrating because there's a lag on TV. And so like watching, like we're huge football and baseball fans, so like watching any draft or anything. Jordan's like, oh, Green Bay took such and such, or like Miami got, I'm like, how, they're not even on that team yet. And he's like, Adam Schefter or whatever on Twitter or whatever. Like they said it like 10 minutes ago. Like it's just a place to, I like it. And it's a little less drama. Versus Facebook, but I do appreciate like the memory function on Facebook.
I will say that like my mom constantly like will like be like, oh, did you hear about this thing? And I'm like, no, what is it? And she'll like tell me, I'm like, oh yeah, I heard about that like 3 weeks ago.
Yeah.
It's like, it doesn't hit Good Morning America until like 3 weeks after it happens on Twitter for some reason. Like the big national stuff, sure. But like some of those weird quirky stories that like Twitter loves to grab. Yeah.
And like reporters live on Twitter. Like the more we're finding.
Yeah,
like,
so that's why we're always there.
Gotcha.
Yeah. You can DM straight to reporters, which is something I'm warming up to because I'm used to like the more the old school email or like call, rip and call. Yeah. But this is like now it's like, oh, you want to just pitch a story? Just send it to their Twitter. So,
yeah.
Well, there you go.
It's a changing world out there.
Media relations in 2022.
Yep.
It's crazy.
All righty. January 30th is National Croissant Day. I'm a big fan of croissants. Yeah, I don't know about y'all.
Absolutely. I'm in.
I mean, it's carbs folded in butter.
It's not a donut, but okay.
Yeah.
One day I aspire to there are certain things that appear to be so challenging that I just want to make them once.
Mm-hmm.
And croissants would be hard to make.
I do believe that croissant is quite difficult to make, which mm-hmm. is why it's on my list of things I would love to make one day.
Yeah.
Not right yet, but I am a big fan of.
I do have to call out January 30th is Madeline's birthday since I called out Savannah. Something big at 8. I feel isn't there a cronut?
Yes.
Yes.
I've heard of those. I've never had one. I remember my friend he lives in Indy now, but he was in Boston when they became a thing. And people would line up around blocks to get these cronuts.
I still like her straight up donut butter.
I don't think I've had one yet. Behind the times.
I quite enjoyed that. We had that in the... we had a similar product. I don't know if it was officially a cronut, mm-hmm. but it was in the Mrs. Claus's kitchen when we had that. Oh. So they were tasty. All righty. Congratulations. I don't even know your way to the end of another episode.
You made it.
Please thank you.
I don't know how you suck it out, but thank you. Please join us in 2 weeks during your next commute, cleaning session, etc. for our next episode, season 4, episode 2, the one where I don't even know.
I thought that was today.
Today was the what's going...
I don't even know. Yeah.
Fair enough.
We're leaning into it.
We'll figure it out before
part
then.
Two.
I should have called out. We didn't even talk about the fact that this was day 2. This was our rescheduled podcast recording day because we had snow.
It actually snowed when
last week. Yeah, it actually snowed, and we actually canceled in anticipation of snow, and it did actually snow for once. But that's okay because I was also getting this cold, the starts of this cold, mm-hmm. and it was pretty nasty. So. We were not going to be in good shape to be around each other anyway. hopefully by the time we need to record our next episode, we'll be a little more together. Thank you to our behind the scenes and now in front of the scenes pod squad. Steven, of course, still behind the scenes, but thank you for being an active participant. Sabrina, thank you for, you're not even behind the scenes anymore. I keep thanking you.
She's all over the scenes.
I just have to make a special thank you to our team, though. There's always stuff going on for this podcast. So, and Josh, of course, thank you for stepping to the front side of the...
Absolutely.
To in front of the scenes.
Thanks, especially to Matt for bringing donuts today.
Yes, thank you.
Sorry, Matt and Lauren and Nell, you missed out. I'm not doing it next time.
Exactly. All right, and thank you to all of you for continuing to listen and interact. I do want to call out that we learned at the end of the year that we're in the top 10% of podcasts.
Woo-hoo.
So if you'd like to help us move up to the top 5%, you can support Holiday World and the Ho-Wo-Po by subscribing and telling all your theme park loving friends, and rate us if you have that option. And if you don't have that option, switch to an app where you can rate us and then rate us. Thank you.
Do it.
We want to hear your feedback and would love to hear our listeners' voices instead of our own. So please call us at 812-937-4401, then dial 8081 to get Steven's long but informative instructions. Thank you to all the listeners we hear from regularly. It truly means a lot to us. And don't forget, we have several prompts in this show. So let us know about your books.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe tell us about your cats, too.
Resolutions.
Resolutions and what you kept and what you broke.
You know what? Go back and listen to it again if you can't remember.
No, you don't have to do that.
On a different platform.
Yep.
Yeah.
All right. Be sure to share your feedback with us when you do write us at podcast@holidayworld.com or reach out to us on social media, but especially Twitter, using the hashtag HoWoPo.
Been listening to the official Holiday World podcast.
Welcome back. Did you enjoy your flight?
A production of Holiday World and Splash and Safari in Santa Claus, Indiana. Check out the latest episodes at holidayworld.com/podcast. Thanks for taking a ride with us.
And please come back to see us again soon.
Are you looking for a fun summer job with flexible schedules? We're hiring now at holidayworldjobs.com.